I just need to check whether you know, you're listening after lunch, and of course a while would have woken you up, but I still need to check if you've gone back to sleep after the, you know, lunch session. So I just want you guys to repeat, you know, or rather do what I do, and actually do what I say. It's better, you know. So all of you, please raise your hands, you know, up in the air. Okay, all are awake. I can see that. When I say clap, please clap. Clap. Okay. I didn't say clap. Most of you clapped, so you're not listening. So I hope the session, you know, will be better. Before I start, I just wanted to introduce, okay, the slides are up there. I wanted to introduce myself. I head the delivery for, you know, what we call as the consumer business unit in Wipro. And, you know, I'm a hardcore delivery guy. So I have had many projects. I've led many projects in my career. And as you know, delivery guys are known for their last failure, right? So you never hear good things about delivery guys. So you'll only be talked about what you failed last. So before I go, you know, we are going through a tremendous digital transformation in the company ourselves. And, you know, I thought I will play a small video about how, you know, our chairman, who doesn't need a lot of introduction on, you know, how he faced, transformation, how he handled change himself in all his career. So just if you could play the video, please, and then we'll move on.
Be an activist. In the 1970s, I decided that if Wipro was to really grow and be successful, I must get people smarter than me to join Wipro. I went around the country trying to hire graduates from the best management institutes in the country. You can imagine how seriously they would have taken me, given my age, when the fact that Wipro was unknown then. An equally big issue was that Wipro had been a traditional family kind of a business till then. Getting professionals from outside and the decision to change the character of the company didn't seem sensible to everyone. But I felt strongly that I had to do this. I felt that unless I became proactive and drove the change, we would continue to remain a cozy small business. In hindsight, that change and its timing has mattered more to Wipro than most other strategic decisions. With this and many other such experiences, I learned that you should change before you have to, meaning it's always better to initiate changes yourself rather than let circumstances force you into them. In my experience, having a purpose energizes, aligns, and gives clarity. And all that is very important always and every day. Believe in yourself. In the early 1990s, Wipro had a non-banking financial services business. Because of many reasons, partly because of our mistakes, partly because of market conditions, that business went bad. We had a huge portfolio of non-performing assets and loans. We also had deposits and other liabilities to our creditors. I remember those to be very difficult days. My colleagues and I toiled on. A number of my colleagues showed remarkable courage and belief. I was personally driven by a simple commitment. Whatever happened, I knew that I would not let down our creditors and depositors. We kept trying our best, and slowly we retrieved the situation. It is from this and other similar circumstances that I have learned that people have unfathomable reserves of strength and ability. It all gets unlocked if they believe in themselves. This deep confidence in yourself also rubs off on people around you. They feel energized and empowered. A leader's sense of confidence can dramatically enhance the performance of their entire team.
Thank you. So it's always inspiring to hear somebody who's gone through so many change and has been very successful, in what they do. So moving on, talk about is, I know many of you are from IT and, you know, some of you are not, but, points here are IT centric, I'm fairly sure it applies equally to, all the other, fields as well, though there is a lot of technology here. I will keep it, fairly simple. One is, we look at, what is transformation? There are, definitions, there, one is, what is transformation itself? One is, what is digital transformation? And what is digital business transformation? You can see, how each one of them, define this. And I like, the way Gartner puts it, which is, using digital technologies and supporting capabilities to, at the end of it, deliver a new digital business model, right? That's a great definition of saying you're putting technology and supporting capabilities, at the end of it, disrupting and bringing in a new ways of working in terms of, your business. So if you look at, there are many, data points out there, I'm sure you must be reading about a lot of digital transformations happening. It's very clear that if you look at it, there are three outcomes in all the transformation programs that we see. One, definitely there is more competitive products that can be released by the customers we work with, by the people who have adopted digital transformation program. Their second outcome is very clearly, because there is new competitive products, they are able to get better market share, generate revenue growth. And the third outcome is very importantly, as many of you know, this improves the customer relationship. At the end of it, you have to retain the customer relationship if you have to grow in this market space now. After all these three things, one of the very important transformation also we see is in the employee engagement. The digital transformation programs enable better engagement of employees that that work in our company, and thereby when there's a better employee engagement, there are many studies which shows at least 9 to 10% of growth can be achieved by a better engaged employee, right? So when there's a digital transformation program, or a digital transformation that happens in your company or in your customer's company, these are the three outcomes. So the question of being on the path of transformation is very clear now. It has to be done. More than 80% of the customers we work with today are in some sort of digital transformation themselves. Of course, there's a various degrees of how successful they are in the transformation, but digital transformation is imminent today. If you see, if you look at our own business in IT especially, we have been growing the share of digital business. We are over 30% of the work that we do today is digital, and we expect that to grow to 60% very soon, in the way things are moving today. So what I wanted to say from this is that digital transformation is very clear. It is here, and if you are not on the boat, we are not in any race today, right? So digital transformation is very important. If you look at when we used to, many of you probably don't relate to this what I'm saying. About 20 to 25 years back, we used to be very happy if we do a release once a year of any of any software product. If we do, then once we came to twice a year, there were a lot of appreciation going all around saying, we have doubled our speed and we are able to do two releases a year. And of course, you know, things have moved on from there. But any guesses today what Amazon does, how many releases they do, and what is the pace of the releases? They release about, they are capable of releasing one every second. You know, so virtually there is no distinction between a release and changes that happen. Most importantly, as Jeff Bezos says here, the agility, which means how quickly can somebody roll out a change, is very important given the current circumstance. The only thing that matters today, because anybody can copy any features, any models today, the only thing that matters today is how quickly we are able to deliver. And the quickness or the responsiveness comes with agility, and that's a great outcome of digital programs. So given this, what I thought I could share with you is in Wipro, how do we see this? And probably there's a learning here, and what are the traits of a good project manager, if you will, how to become digitally enabled and be ready for a transformation. Of course, transformation is a bigger word, but there are many projects which make up a transformation. But at the end of it, all of us have to contribute to the transformation. So the first thing is, I've simplified this with what's called the digital quotient. It's nothing to do with the DQ of the Mollywood local hero here, but it probably mimics the same thing. The digital quotient the way we want to enable our project managers is, increase the digital quotient measured in four different levers. One is how can each of the PM can adopt newer digital work methods. The work methods include, the agile, DevOps, and, all the new things that are coming up. How quickly are they able to adopt this? How quickly they're able to learn, and how quickly they're able to use this in their project, right? So one part of their of the trait is how can they develop digital work methods. So I'm going to speak about quickly on how are we enabling our project teams with this. So that is one part of the traits people have to pick up. The second one is on technologies. Irrespective of what business we are in, I think it is very, very important to get deeper into a technology. If people remain paper pushers, they'll probably be that. They'll have to do only that work in the future. You have to get deeper into a technology, specialize into a technology, understand what's happening in, it could be one, it could be two areas, but you cannot be zero areas in your area of work. So it could be IoT, it could be cloud, it could be analytics, it could be various tools, it could be various platforms that exist today, full stack. There are many many options today, but you still have to get deeper into technology. I mean, don't remain outside technology. Technology is definitely a trait or a skill as a project manager we need to develop if you were to be in the digital transformed world for tomorrow. The third one is experience mapping. There are many situations today where if we don't understand the customer point of view in all our projects, in all the work that we do, it's very difficult to take decisions in the project, right? I see the old world PM still struggling in taking decisions which are not necessarily coming from the customer standpoint, but more from a project standpoint, saying I am constrained by this tool, I'm constrained by this timeline, I'm constrained by various things, but not taking a call based on the customer point of view. So one has to develop a design thinking, one has to develop the way customers are going to use your product, customers are going to benefit from your product, and we have to think from the customer point of view. And it's absolutely a must. If we don't understand that, I think we are going to be in the failed category of projects in the today morning that we learnt about, right? So very important to again do a experience mapping. And the fourth one is, I think there were many mentions today in the morning. I was noticing there are many mentions of automation. A lot of tasks that we do today can be automated, and you know, there's unimaginable innovation happening in automation. There are companies dedicated looking at, you know, see, earlier the world used to be, let's take what we are doing today and automate whatever we can, right? That was the first step. I think today, what people are thinking is, can we create things that are naturally amenable for automation? So it is not going to be that, first you'll develop and then think of automation. People are developing things that are amenable for automation. It is here, automation is here, and it is going to take over a lot of tasks that we do for a good reason, right? We don't want many failed projects. We don't want many, many things, the manual errors happening in many of the work that we do. So automation, please spend a lot of time on automation. See what is happening in that area. What are the things that you can automate? You don't have to be, the Watson of IBM, but you can be your own area's, automation expert. You can look at what you're working today and what are the things that are necessary for automation, right? For example, crowdsourcing is a new, thing that's going on. At Wipro, we have something called the Top Coder. There are 1 million people who have registered, including some people from Wipro, on that platform who are outside Wipro, right? Wipro and few people from Wipro and outside. There are 1 million registered people whom we have access to. And today, we are able to design challenges for the, for this Top Coder, and ask people to contribute, and they get paid only when their solution is selected, right? It's an amazing talent out there in the market. So it can be called automation in some way that, I don't care about many things that I don't use. I only pick the thing that works. But that's again a very interesting phenomenon. There are a lot of changes happening in our areas of work. So please be a little, open. Be a little sensitive to, what is happening around, and quickly adopt these things. If your competitor is able to, do crowdsourcing better, you are completely at a loss, right? So think of outsourcing and automation as a key lever. So again, to summarize, these are the four traits that I have seen are very important for the for the project managers, for somebody who is running a project in the part of a digital journey. These are some traits that I've tried to summarize. Having said that, many people spoke about people. There were many talk on people today morning. So if you see, what are some of the people aspects that come into play? Those are the four traits I spoke about. But from a management of team standpoint, if you see, there are two important aspects that come in. One, we should learn to manage diverse teams, the teams which are, very different culturally, very different in their thought process, and you cannot say what Val was mentioning that, why can't you see it my way? That's not a question that we can ask, right? So very culturally different teams, right? We have to learn to manage that. Second is, how do we manage globally distributed teams? You could be a local player, but you will be, exposed to global forces in many ways, right? So both global in nature and diverse in nature becomes very important people skills that we have to develop. I can give several examples of, if you miss the boat on, say, distributed teams. For example, we were looking at one of the project, was getting into a red zone recently, and when I looked at and spoke to the customer, they were very averse of working with a globally diverse team. And then when we asked many whys, I came to know that the SME of that project had to go home at 5 p.m. every day, right? Because she had a nursing baby at home. And nobody understood that, it's such a simple issue, and she had to go home at 5, and she could not stay beyond 5 at office. So we made some arrangements to take care of that, and the project is back to where it should be. But I'm saying, you know, those are some very simple people issues that can put the whole project in red, and they were not accepting a global diverse team. So there are many, you know, nuances with all the technology frameworks, all the other things that I spoke about in the, you know, previous, the four trades. We could get all that right, but if we don't get the sensitivities around people right, you know, we could go to a place where we don't want to be. So again, I'm trying to simplify. You know, you heard this quote from Mr. Premji as well. Please change before you have to. And you can see the Jack Welch, saying the same thing. So coming back to Wipro, what are we doing? I have 4 minutes remaining. Coming back to what we're doing at Wipro, we have very robust program, which is again, you know, accredited by PMI. We have an entry-level project manager course, and then we have a project management academy, courses within Wipro. And these have been very successful in the sense that, these are about 80 hours of training. One can choose either online or classroom, and then they are assessed both in person and online, and then they're certified, and then they get projects to execute right beside them, right? So they can be part of projects. Usually it takes about 6 months, even though the training is about 80 hours. We give them that time and space to pick up the skills and be a robust project manager. We have over 3,000 people who are certified in this road. We've also introduced the new age project management from the last two quarters, because in the new age world now, things are quite different, especially when it comes to beating the Amazon kind of releases. I was talking to you about a release a second is not very easy unless you put a whole lot of things in place and they come together when it comes together for working, right? So that's very important. And so we have put together a program for new age last two quarters. Fairly successful so far. We need to fine-tune that and make sure it is relevant as we go forward. So these are some of the things we are doing. The way the outcomes of this project management, these are some responses that we have got from people who have gone through these courses, and we believe it's in the right direction. People talking about new methods, how to use better IPs that are in Wipro, how to be more agile and digital, right? So there's a lot more exposure, a lot more global team that is coming into place, and I certainly believe we are in the right direction. So I have a couple of minutes, probably if there is any question. I just went through quickly to sort of give you a flavor on what we see as the need for change. What are the traits for a good project manager? What are we doing at Wipro, right? That was the summary. I would be happy if you have any questions or post the session. I'm more than happy to answer anything. Yeah, you had a question.
What is your biggest failure and what you have learned from that?
My?
Yes.
Yeah, I need about 1.5 hours for that. But, I can tell many things. One of the things, in fact, I had a session with my team on my top 5 failures in life. And there's the good thing is, I was emphasizing on the learning that I had with that. For me, personally, one of the biggest learning has been, in one of the projects where I worked as I still, if you ask me, what was my best role in life? I would say it was the project manager role, because it had full accountability, but zero authority. It seemed like I couldn't get a lot of things approved, but I am fully accountable for things. So I enjoyed that role. As somebody said, challenges is what makes it interesting. So I was in a customer location as a project manager, and we were so energetic, and we put together. We used to work over the weekends for about 3 months continuously. We never had a break, 7 days a week, and we ran, every day long hours. And 4th month, we see the project manager or our customer liaison, has made a project plan which includes our weekend. We always thought we are doing good by working on weekends, working long hours, but that had become the norm. Right? So I understood that. That's one of my big learning, that the expectation that you set is very important with the customer. Right? If you have set the expectation that you are of the type who will work long hours over the weekend, that became the project plan. And then it was very difficult to beat them with effort. We had to only beat them with more outcome. Right? So there are many learnings. As I said, I need a lot of time for that. But it's a good question. All right. Thank you very much.